Hi, greetings to everybody. My name is Benny Liao, and I'm honored to be the moderator for the closing keynote address by Dr. Reza Shah-Kazemi on the theme of a Quranic view of religion, science, and ecology in our conference on the application of religion and science and ecology and sustainability perspectives from Islam and Buddhism. This will be on Sunday, January 16, 2022, Malaysia time, 4 p.m. Let me give a brief introduction of our distinguished keynote speaker. Dr. Reza Shah-Kazemi is an author and lecturer in the fields of comparative religion, Islamic spirituality, and Quranic studies. Among his works are Path to Transcendence, according to Shankara, Ibn Arabi, and Mr. Eckhart, which was published in 2006, and the award-winning Justice and Remembrance, Introducing the Spirituality of Imam Ali, also in 2006. Dr. Reza is also the author of Common Grounds Between Islam and Buddhism, which was published in 2010, a groundbreaking book that explores the scriptural and spiritual tenets of both Islam and Buddhism in relation to one another, thereby creating a basis for comparison and analysis of the two great spiritual traditions. Dr. Reza studied international relations and politics at Sussex and Exeter Universities in the UK before obtaining his PhD in comparative religion at the University of Kent. He is also currently a senior research associate at the Institute of Ismaili Studies in London. Let me now invite Dr. Reza to share some salient points of his keynote address. So over to you, Dr. Reza.
Thank you very much, Benny. Much appreciated. The salient points. I'm going to do my best to compress within about 40 minutes, I think, I'll be speaking, and try to compress in those 40 minutes a Quranic perspective on religion, science, and ecology. Those three dimensions are, in a sense, encapsulated by the word tawhid, which is often very simplistically translated simply as oneness or unity, the unity of God, the unity of being. But in fact, tawhid is a word which means making one, declaring one, realizing one. And therefore, this oneness in question is much more of a dynamic process rather than a static concept. So applying this to the fields of religion, science, and ecology, I'm going to present a view which may be called the science of signs, of ayat. Ayat is the plural of the word ayah. In Arabic, it means a sign, it means a phenomenon, it can also mean a miracle. And the Quran refers to its own verses of scripture as being ayat, but it also refers to the signs on the horizons all around us. All of the phenomena of virgin nature are likewise understood as scriptural revelations, and that it's up to us to decode, interpret those signs and to apply concretely in our intellectual, spiritual, and our moral lives the principles embedded in those signs. And this is given very clearly in a couple of two or three sets of verses. We could put them together and see what we're talking about. That in chapter number 49, the Surah Fussilat, there's a clear expression of these interacting signs on the horizons and within our own souls, where we're told we shall show them our signs on the horizons and in their own souls, such that it will become clear to them that he is the truth, that it is the truth, referring to the ultimate reality. And so there's a correspondence between the microcosmic signs within the soul and the macrocosmic and ultimately metacosmic signs on the horizons. And that those signs on the horizons are to be identified with so many mirrors reflecting the one and only reality of the divine essence, the divine face. They are manifestations of the divine essence. And this is given in another verse in which we're told, this is verse 115 of chapter number 2, Surah Al-Baqarah, that unto God belong the east and the west. Wherever you turn, there is the face of God. And so the face of God is there, reflected in the mirrors of these phenomena of nature, Mother Nature, all around us. Wherever we turn, there is the face of the one and only reality reflected in that mirror. How do we see that? By going deep within ourselves, rather than just imagining that the face of God will appear out there. We go deep within ourselves to examine our inner our temple, if you like. We have when we say the word contemplation, we are making ourselves into a temple, so that we first have to find something of those outward manifestations, those outward mirrors in the horizons. We have to find them within ourselves first. And this correspondence between the individual and the universal, or between the microcosm and the macrocosm, this is absolutely crucial to what I would call a tawhidi understanding of the relationship between religion, science, and ecology. Because when we're talking, let's start with the last part, ecology, and build back through the science of science to the whole question of a religious or spiritual, better metaphysical understanding of where we are in this playing out, this global crisis, and what is it that we can do about it practically, because that's one of the main points that I would like to make at the end of the presentation, which is spiritual action, a metaphysical response to the physical crisis, and not just pretending that we can deal with the crisis on the physical level alone through social engineering and through changing policies here and there, because the nature, the cause of the crisis ecologically is to do with a fundamental malaise, a fundamental disorientation on the level of the spirit, and therefore morality and ethical action vis-a-vis the environment, vis-a-vis our economy, vis-a-vis all of the technologies that we have put into place that are disrupting the natural environment the way we're seeing, because the causes of the environmental crisis are fundamentally spiritual and then moral and instrumental and so on. We have to have a mode of response which is commensurate with that cause. And so the mode of response has to be spiritual rather than just, you know, physical and outward and practical. It's questionable whether any degree of policy change is going to make any dent in this roller coaster machine, this locomotive that's out of control. But what can and will change, and this is, I suppose, I should now say the most important point that I want to get across in the presentation, is this. A verse which tells us in the Holy Quran, God will not change the condition of a people until they change the condition of their own souls. Inna Allah la yughayyiru ma bi qawmin hatta yughayyiru ma bi anfusihim. It's all about changing oneself And when a sufficient number of people on earth are really changing themselves in terms of their attitudes, in terms of their dispositions, and in terms of, I would put it, for those of us who are engaged in this Buddhist-Muslim dialogue, we are believers in contemplative practice. We're practitioners. And that's the point, that when you're practicing the principle and not just spouting about it, when you're practicing it as a contemplative, when you are focusing your soul, your mind, your heart, your will, your disposition, your orientation completely on the principle of universal love, beauty, compassion, and when you're doing this constantly, then you cannot but have a benefic effect upon your environment, even if it's not going to be palpable, measurable in any scientific way. The Quran tells us that مَا خَلْقَكُمْ وَمَا بَعْضُكُمْ إِلَّا كَنَفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ. Your creation, in the plural, your creation as humanity, and your resurrection, your being raised up again after death, is but as the creation, the resurrection of a single soul. There is this extraordinary morphic resonance, to use the word of the phrase of Rupert Sheldrake, the famous biologist, who talked about the subtle morphic resonance, these resonances between every single phenomenon in nature, which of course is now being indubitably established by quantum mechanics and modern physics, that we are all subtly interconnected, and that a small change in one environment can have multiplied effects in other environments. And if this is being detected now on the purely biological and physical levels, then it's an intimation as to what is happening on a much higher and immeasurable level of the spirit, of the spiritual interconnectedness of all of us. So this is where I would put the emphasis on, for the purposes of our dialogue, especially between those of us who are actually seriously engaged in prayer, we should not dissociate that from the solution, quote, to the environmental crisis. When we look at what the Quran says about our relationships with the other communities, the species, we see that we are not only communities. Ummah is the word used. The Quran tells us in one verse, there is no bird flying with wings or an animal on the earth, but that it belongs to a community. They are all part of communities like yourselves. Ummamun. They are ummah, which is the plural of ummah. Ummah is the word, rooted in the same word for mother, but an ummah is a community. And they, those communities, have modes of revelation. Wahi, the bee in the chapter entitled The Bee. The bee is told that, we are told rather, to look at the way in which the bee receives wahi from its lord, and is told to wend its way through and to make its hives, and we get this wonderful sustaining and healing honey from this magnificent creature. But these are ways in which God is helping us to see that all of the other species are communities like us, and therefore the loss of even one of these species is not just a kind of catastrophe in terms of the cosmos, but it's a sacrilege in terms of divine creativity, that we are destroying the manifestations of the marvelous beauty of divine creativity. That's what we're doing when we're allowing these species just to become extinct. So the other important point I think I will make in the presentation is this, that the Quran tells us that these species, every single creature on earth, has its mode of prayer, its mode of glorifying the Creator, its way of responding to this revelation, which by nature now it manifests. What the animals and the bees and the birds and fish, what they all do by nature, expressing the revelations that are coming to them from their Lord, to do what they do by nature, we have to learn to do by supernature. We have to become supernaturally natural by responding to the revelation that God has put into our fundamental, primordial, immutable human nature, our fitra, what's called in the Quran, our fitra. And this is described in the Quran as the eternally established religion, the Deen al-Qayyim, that is almost identical to the phrase Sanatana Dharma, the Dharma that is eternal, the eternal law, the eternal way, the eternal revelation, the eternal religion. And the Deen al-Qayyim is what? Dalika Deen al-Qayyim, walakinna akthara nas la ya'lamun. That, the fitra, is the eternally established religion. But most people know it not. So this integration of our own spiritual activity into the natural activity, which is revealed by God to all of the communities in existence, this is something that we have to learn from our fellow creatures. And we are told in two or three verses of the Quran, one verse the Quran says, إِن مِّن شَيْءٍ إِلَّا يُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِهِ. There is nothing, that no thing in existence that does not worship, does not glorify God with praise, does not hymn his praise with glory. Every single thing is doing it all the time in the natural world by virtue of just their mode of existence. We have to learn from the birds. I think immediately after that, it says, وَالطَّيْرُ سَافَاتٍ كُلٌّ قَدْ عَلِمَ صَلَاتَهُ وَتَسْبِيحًا. And look at the birds in flight. Safat. In the Arabic, when you recite this, you have to prolong. If you're reciting according to Tajweed, you have to prolong that safat to six beats so that you get a sense of these birds flying. And you're invited to enter into the song that they are making by virtue of their flight, by doing your salah, that each one of these birds, the safatin, every single one knows salatahu, their salat, their mode of prayer, and their tasbih, their mode of glorification, their way of glorifying, like the angels are all the time. The birds in flight is given as the image, the symbol of what's happening in our natural environment all the time, and we have to learn and therefore do our own mode of glorification, our own mode of meditation, our own mode of contemplation, our own mode of interiorization, because that's what we are called to do, to go deep within ourselves and to observe within our souls the signs, the ayat, the miraculous manifestations of God's names and qualities within ourselves, before we're going to see the face of God that manifests those names and qualities and beauties and harmonies outside of ourselves. So that's a kind of summary, not particularly systematic or coherent, but that's a summary of what I proposed to say in the presentation.
Thank you, Reza. Thank you very much for highlighting the key points of your keynote address. We appreciate very much, and we look forward to listening to your full speech during the coming conference, which will be held on January 16th, Sunday at 4 p.m. Malaysia time, which will be 8 a.m. I think in the UK. Right. So until then, stay safe and wish you all the best, and see you soon. Thank you.